One thing that's probably crossed your mind is a high-end gaming PC with the latest 6800 XTs and RTX 3080s hitting the market. They definitely offer a performance boost versus the previous generation cards. And of course, with the new Zen 3 5000 series CPUs out, that is the 5950X 16 core, one must wonder, how much power do you actually need to build this gaming PC? Well, today, we're gonna help answer that question where Deepcool sent us out a heap of their different stuff with their DQ 850 watt power supply. And they said, look, we want you to stress the living yes out of this power supply. And I said to myself, well, sure. And then they said, look, we'll sponsor the video too. So today's video is sponsored. However, that being said, if I do find some problems with this stuff, sponsor video or not, I'm still gonna report it to you guys during this time. But let's pull that proverbial tech genie out of the bottle and start building this high-end gaming rig. And now that we've completed the build, one thing we can do is go into the BIOS, and here we're gonna get a readout of our voltages, which is pretty important if you, say for instance, a lot of people can just do this and easily check if they're running a very bad power supply, if they're running something that's really good or something that's mediocre. Now, these voltages here are very important, these three, the 12 volt, the 5 volt, and the 3.3 volt. And the closer they are to that spec on the right here, I guess the more, well, the better and more normalized your power supply is going to be. So this 12 volt here, we want this generally to be within 5% over or under. So that would make it 11.4 volt or better, or 12.6 volt and under. So we can see here, it's right on 12, pretty much. Only like a smidgen over 12. So it's running really well on the 12 volt line. The 5 volt is 4.97. So that's coming very close to that spec as well. And then the 3.3 volt is again coming very close to the 3.3 number. So this power supply is already giving out very close to the numbers that we want here. Now, another thing as we can see here is with your CPU vCore voltage, this is on Ryzen specifically, where it is running pretty high out of the box at 1.45 volt. And it goes up, and we see here 1.47. AMD have said this isn't a problem because it's only a worry if your CPU is amping at these voltages. In other words, if you're at full load and your CPU was then consuming 1.45 volt, then it would be a problem. So it's nothing to worry about. If you see this, or according to AMD, this is nothing to worry about because it's not being amped at this voltage. But first, a quick little overclock here at 4.6 gigahertz on the 5950X with the memory locked in with 64 gigabytes at 3600 megahertz, which this motherboard is actually, with this CPU, is taking it. So that's very good news, especially if you're a video editor. And now the second test for checking out this power supply is where we'll get onto the third soon, where we're just gonna load it up with a heap of different power consumption. But this test right here is just on the GPU, because what we're doing with the RTX 3080 is we're checking if the ripple suppression is good or not. And what we can do here is load it up with a benchmark called Furmark, which is what we've got up on the screen. And since the RTX 3080 has the unique ability to monitor input voltage, we can then sort of use that as a budget way, instead of going out and spending thousands on oscilloscopes, we can use this as a budget way to see how much ripple we have on our 12 volt line. And from our benchmarking here, we can see at the highest peak we've got around 11.875 volt, and then to our lowest point is around 11.85. And so that's around a 25 millivolt variance, which is okay. It's actually really good. And I have seen around 10 millivolts. That's sort of like the best in the industry at the moment. Though I guess at its price point, which is coming in at around 189 Aussie dollars in America, I think it's around $120, is looking like the ripple's actually pretty solid for the money, considering it's also a modular power supply too. So these numbers have checked out, and also the numbers that we checked in the BIOS just to check that our rails were running at the right voltage spec are also checking out too. So what we're going to do now, however, is load up this GPU and Cinebench and then put the two together and see how much we can load from the wall to stress test on this power supply to see if it holds up. We now have Furmark loaded up, and our GPU, the good news is our GPU is around 100% power consumption here, which is what I was hoping for, because usually when you load up a CPU heavy benchmark and then a GPU heavy one, you don't actually hit 100% perfectly on both. But the GPU is hovering near 100%, CPU is going pretty hard as well, and we're juicing nearly 800 watts from the wall. And this is from a single CPU and a single GPU. So it's actually quite good that we're doing this on air, especially since we're testing out the 850 watt power supply. Since Nvidia does recommend you use a 750 watt, but I don't think they'd see someone like me just overclocking the living crap out of their CPU and GPU at the same time to try and max a power supply on two, I guess, really strenuous benchmarks, because Furmark is one of the most power hungry benchmarks you can run on a GPU, and R23 is the latest Cinebench, which does use some of the latest instruction sets to really stress test your CPU. We see here the CPU is going to around 93 degrees and the GPU is going to max 69 degrees. Magical number, of course, was 69. So what we're going to do now, however, this is with the side panel off, so we're going to check if these CL500 cases from Deepcool are any good. And what we've got here is three fans on outtake, three fans on intake with the 360 mil rad, and we're going to see if we put the side panel on, are these temperatures going to go up from 69 and 93 respectively any higher, or are they going to potentially go down, which I have seen in some rare instances with cases with very strong orientations towards high airflow. And after running these benchmarks now with the side panel on, there's actually some really good news for this case. I'll be flabbergasted. That is that we went to 90.5 degrees maximum. So 1.8 degrees cooler with the side panel on. And then for the GPU, that remained at 69 degrees. So there was no change there. So what this means is that this case has the proper channels if the fans are good enough. And what we've put in this case, though, there is credit where credit's due, and that is the MF120 GT fans that we've got here. So we've got three included with the Castle 360X, which is the water cooler we're using. And then we've got an additional three pack, which we've put two up the top and one at the side here. So we've got three MF120s intake, three MF120s outtake, and it's holding up well, though it is getting a little bit noisy with the side panel on versus off. It does drop the decibels about 1 decibel. So it is still pretty noisy, but do keep in mind, this is running around 800 watts of heat. It is quite a lot of power to push through a PC. If anything, I'd be trying to go the other way and undervolt the RTX 3080 to see if I can sweet spot both these out and have a daily driver that uses a lot less power. And with that, we'll have not only cooler temps, but we'll also have quieter noise. Though one more test that you guys have requested that I do is World of Warcraft Shadowlands. For some reason, people are like, yo, Shadowlands, let's see what the results are. And so we're gonna leave the overclocks on the GPU, we're gonna leave the overclocks on the CPU, but we're gonna jump into Shadowlands and put up real-time monitoring of temperatures of CPU and GPU, as well as checking the power consumption from the wall while we're playing this game at 4K resolution scale. Don't only see what FPS we get, but to see how the, I guess, Furmark and Cinebench scenario is a bit unrealistic when it comes to real world gaming. And there we have it with World of Warcraft. We set this, even though we're playing at 1080p, we set it to 4K in terms of the resolution scale, whereas at 200%, max settings at a scale of the slider, we pulled that all the way to 10, MSAA 2X, and we still had near 200 FPS. This game maxes out at 200 FPS. We're getting in the new Shadow Lands update in this main area, we were just hovering above like 150 the whole time. And when I was testing this for the 6800 XT review, I was in another area that actually wasn't Shadowlands, and that was getting a little bit less FPS. So it seems like if you guys are into World of Warcraft, you're going to get the same experience in terms of graphics out of the new expansion as you have out of pretty much every World of Warcraft that's been released beforehand since Frozen Throne. So that's my opinion there. I mean, the game's gonna run absolutely fine. Another thing is too, is that you've got a maximum power draw of 515 watts with an overclocked Aorus 3080 and an overclocked 5950X while we're playing this game. So the power consumption when you're playing games, it goes down a lot compared to that test that we threw at this system beforehand, where it's pretty much perfectly maxing the GPU and the CPU in perfect harmony with unrealistic instruction sets that would go together. That sort of puts on this real heavy strain, but it's good for testing out temperatures, max loads, and also, especially in this case, the power supply, where the 850 watt DQ handled things absolutely fine. Now, in terms of this whole build cost here, this one's really expensive. It's coming over just over 3,000 USD. And in terms of the Australian cost, it's coming in around 4,800 Aussie dollars. So if you want something that's pretty much gonna be the best of the best, as it stands for not just gaming, but also productivity, since we threw in 64 gigabytes of Dominator memory, I think if you're going to go with a 5950X, you're definitely gonna go for the 16 cores, 32 threads. And so when you go for that productivity play, it's always good to have 64 gigabytes of RAM. For instance, if I only have 32 gigabytes of RAM, I get all sorts of crashing and errors in Premiere Pro when I'm editing 4K content. 64 gigabytes seems to alleviate that. So it is definitely something to consider if you're doing this for workstation and sort of gaming secondary, then this is definitely gonna be something that may be worth your while considering, especially if the time is gonna save you money in the long run. Though in terms of the other components, especially the ones Deepcool sent out, because they really wanted me to take a look at it, run it through the paces, I was actually really impressed with the CL500 and the MF120mm fans. Those MF120s, they could pull and push a lot of air. And this case, when we put the side panel on with that huge airflow, that would actually drop the temperatures of the CPU. So that was really impressive to see. I was actually expecting it to rise a little bit, which I've seen a lot of cases around this price point ever so. Even though they've got good airflow, they do raise the temperatures ever so slightly. So really good job in the terms of this design on this case. Whether the aesthetic is for you or not, I think it's a different kind of space age look, but I really am digging two things about this case, and that is the magnetic sides, where they've got a really tough tension as well. So they're not gonna fall off if you're just casually carrying this case around, but if you are transporting it long distances, I would take the side panels off first and then just cart the PC around, because if the side panel falls off, the glass one, and that drops, then that's gonna be a big mess. Though another thing is too, it's got the GPU support bracket, which will hold up and stop your GPU from sagging. As we saw with this Aorus 3080, this thing is huge. It's a mammoth tank times like three. If you guys ever played the old Command and Conquers, you got the mammoth tanks. This thing is like three of them in your case because you've got three fans. And this thing like holds the card up. So over time, you're not gonna get that sag and that undesirable aesthetic. And I guess if you're going to go spend this amount of money on a PC, it's little things like that that do make a difference. So CL500, impressive. The MF120s, they're going for a different look, but the most important thing is the airflow is really good on those fans. And then it came to the 360EX. That CPU cooler is sort of like run of the mill. It's doing a pretty good job. It can handle the 5950X at 4.6 gigahertz, though it didn't do anything to wow me or impress me, as opposed to the case and the MF120s. And then of course the DQ850, that's coming in with a really good price performance price tag, considering we put it through what we put it through today, and it's modular, it's got the gold rating for efficiency. And another thing they wanted me to mention is that if you're in Australia, you can get this with a $20 discount at M-Wave for a 2-week period. I think it makes this power supply around 169 Aussie dollars, and that's including GST. So if you're in Australia and you want a really good power supply to power your high-end RTX 3080, 3090, or 6800 XT, or whole build, and you want to overclock, then this power supply is going to do a really good job of doing that. So I'll put some links in the description below for you guys. If you enjoyed today's video, then be sure to hit that like button. If you've got any questions about things we did in today's video, be sure to drop a comment down below too. And with that aside, we have our question of the day, which comes from Jeff Zest. And they ask, it's in relation to 4K monitors. They ask, BenQ3270U or this? And they're talking about the ViewSonic VP 32 inch. And I've tested out both of these. They're 10-bit panels. And I'm guessing Jeff knows what he wants when he's asking about these monitors, because they're really geared up towards video editing because they're both calibrated out of the factory, which means that they've got accurate colors and they're good to go straight for video and photo editing. Now, in terms of either one of these, I would just get whichever one's cheapest where you are at locally. That's always when I see products and they're coming so close to one another, I usually just recommend grabbing whichever is going to save you the most money, because there's not going to, you're just going to be thinking about these differences. You're going to go back and forth. Which should I pick? Which should I get? And that time wasted could be time that's spent productive elsewhere to make up the difference anyway. So between these two monitors, there's not much of a difference at all. They're both really good for video editing and photo editing. Get whichever one's cheapest. Hope that answers your question. If you guys have stayed this far and you're enjoying that Tech Yes content, then be sure to hit that sub button, ring that bell, and I'll catch you in the next one. Peace out for now. Bye.